right, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to Riverside Baptist Church. In front of you, you'll find a songbook. Should be blue. Grab that songbook, turn to page 509. I've found a friend who is all to me. Saved, saved, saved. Let's stand together and sing all three verses of 509. I've found a friend who is all to me. His love is ever true. I love to tell how he lifted me and what his grace can do for me. Saved by his power divine, saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. He saves me from every sin. My joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. Amen. How many of you are glad you're saved today? Amen. Good. You sound like it. Turn over to page 577. Be strong in the Lord. We'll sing all three verses of 577.
For
conquest a foe. Fear not the battle, for the victory is always his. He will protect you wherever you go. Be strong in the Lord of good courage, for he is your guide. Be strong in the Lord, and rejoice, for the victory is yours.
Hallelujah. Thank you very kindly. You may be seated.
All right, and you may be seated, sir. Thank you.
My sufficient, efficient servant has just taken over so much while I've been absent and done a splendid job, and I'm thankful that both of you want to see me back.
Amen.
So I remember all my friends, and I'm glad you're both here this morning. No, seriously, this is just exciting to be in the house of God. And this kind of music just gets you excited.
Amen.
I was telling him in Sunday school years ago, many years ago, I tried some things that were different. I can't tell you about them now, but they heard about it in Sunday school. And one of them was, on Sunday morning, I just want to do something different. You know, you get in a rut. I told him in Sunday school, they taught me in college, a rut is a good thing if it's going someplace, such as in sand. If it's going someplace, stay in the rut. If it's in ice and snow, if it's going someplace, stay in the rut. And so they said, however, a rut is kind of like a coffin with both ends knocked out. You know, you're not going anywhere. And I just wanted to get out of a rut. So I'll tell you one of them. That Sunday morning, we didn't have music. At 11 o'clock, I stepped to the pulpit desk, and I said, open your Bibles to a particular passage, and I preached. And then when I finished, we just reversed everything. Now, it went over like a lead balloon. I mean, people sitting there going, we're not a Baptist church anymore. In a Baptist church, I was telling them in Sunday school, you sing first, second, and last verses. If a song has five verses, you sing the first, second, and last verses. That's a Baptist church. And I just wanted to do something different. Thank you for good, encouraging, exciting singing this morning. It's good to be back. Thank you for praying for my wife. The progress that she's making is very slow. It's kind of like two steps forward, one step back, two more. Well, you're still ahead of the game, so to speak. And this medication that she was given is, I think, slowly dissipating, coming out of the system and so forth. And her body has suffered somewhat of a shock, so that's why she hasn't been in church in some time. She said, I just want to go to church. She said, I want to go to church, so I brought her to church yesterday. I said, get in the car, we're going for a ride. She said, I want something exciting in my life. So after we left here, we were here for a few minutes, and she had picked up some missionary letters and so forth. Then I took her out on Interstate 95. Now that'll get your mind off yourself.
Oh, yeah.
Oh boy. Unless it puts you in a prayerful mood. Oh Lord, get me out of this awful place. So good to have you here today. Good to see everybody. Thank you for your support. Okay, Pastor. Whatever you want to do, you do, but you'll have prayer, please.
Okay, yes, sir. I think he's excited to get back to the pulpit.
Amen.
And that's a good thing. Amen. Amen. Yes. I am excited to have him back. I tell you, when somebody's that excited to get to the pulpit, you better be looking forward to the message, because this is going to be a good day, I believe. Look, God, praise the Lord for Pastor Dean and his faithfulness. Thankful to see some of you haven't seen in a while here today, Matt and Gwan. Slay, good to have you back here today. Wonderful. Heather has some family visiting. Doug and Savannah?
Sonia.
Sonia, it's good to have you here today. Wonderful. And then, of course, Pastor's here again today, so we're glad to see him back.
Amen.
All right. Just a few announcements this morning. There is a ladies' Bible study starting back up on October the 27th, and it's going to be every Tuesday at 10 a.m., so that's starting back up again, October 27th. This is in the bulletin. It starts at 10 a.m. And you need to see Sarah Stevens for a book. The book cost $11, and she has the books with her today. And if you would like to be a part of that and would like to purchase the book, please see Sarah Stevens. We are going to have a teen activity on this coming Friday, October the 23rd. And it's going to be a fun teen activity, like all of our teen activities are. I mean, we haven't had a dud yet, I don't think. I mean, maybe the teens think we do, but as far as I'm concerned, we have not had a dud yet. And so 10/23, that's October 23rd at 6 p.m., we'll be having another teen activity. And there is a sign-up list in the foyer, in the lobby, on a glass table there for our fellowship dinner, which will be November 1st. That's going to be November 1st after the evening service. It's going to be a taco night, I think. And so there's sign-ups for some of the toppings for the tacos, for people to bring some of the toppings, and then also for waters. So was there dessert as well in there? And for dessert on the sign-up sheet. So if you can want to get prepared for that for November 1st, please do that. That sign-up sheet is in the foyer. What a blessing it is to be in the house of the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for your many blessings. We thank you so much for a church where we can come, Lord, and fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ and be able to present ourselves before you, Lord, in your house. And then, Lord, to be able to hear a message rooted in the Bible, Lord, and to be able to hear the truth of your word of God, the word of God proclaimed. Lord, we pray that you would bless this service greatly. Lord, what a blessing for these that came. And Lord, sometimes as we sit in the pew, Lord, sometimes our minds wander, but Lord, I pray that today you would help us to be very attentive. Very attentive, Lord, to the word of God as it's preached. Lord, I pray for our wonderful pastor. Thank you so much for helping Mrs. Dean to get a little bit better, and we pray for her continued healing, Lord, and to be completely better soon. We ask you for that, Lord. But we thank you for Pastor being in his place this morning, and we pray that your blessings would be upon him as he brings forth the word of God. Lord, speak to our hearts and help us to make decisions for thee. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Page 387, I will follow. Let's all stand together as we sing all three verses of I will follow before our scripture. And we're going to sing the third verse first today. Amen. Verse number 3.
I surrender all, my Savior. I hold no thing back from thee. Every part is thine to use, Lord, thy living sacrifice to me. I rest in thee, trust in thee, I place my life in your hands.
Thank you.
Let's do that chorus without the instruments. I rest in thee, trust in thee, I place my life in thy hand. I will follow thee, my Savior, lead on, my shepherd. Please remain standing for the reading of the word of the Lord. Brother Don.
All right, Psalm 119, verse 161. Princes I have persecuted, let me start again. Princes have persecuted me without a cause, but my heart standeth in awe of thy word. I rejoice at thy word as one that findeth great spoil. I hate and abhor lying, but thy law do I love. Seven times a day I do praise thee because of thy righteous judgments. Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Lord, I have hoped for thy salvation and done thy commandments. My soul hath kept my testimonies, and I love them exceedingly. I have kept thy precepts and thy testimonies, for all my ways are before thee. Amen. Today we pray and thank the Lord for all they've given us. Help us to understand thy word today and lead us on into victory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Mark, please, chapter 1. I'm going to read through verses 7 and 8 this morning. Mark, please, chapter 1. This is a message I began a couple of Sunday mornings ago. Did not have an opportunity to finish it. Hope to have that opportunity today. But I understand that the human mind can only absorb as much as the human seat can endure. So, I often say that's why we have an air-conditioned building and 2.5 to 3 inches of foam padding to our pews. We just want you to endure more. All right, please, Mark chapter 1. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets, "Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee." The voice of one crying in the wilderness, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." John did baptize in the wilderness and preached the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And there went out unto him all the land of Judea and they of Jerusalem, and were all baptized of him in the river of Jordan, confessing their sins. And John was clothed with camel's hair and with a girdle of a skin about his loins, and he did eat locust and wild honey, and preached, saying, "There cometh one mightier than I after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to stoop down and unloose. I indeed have baptized you with water, but he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost." If John the Baptist were with us today, he'd have a little patience. I think maybe he was a man of great patience. I'd like to think so. I'd like sometimes to think I have a lot of patience, and sometimes I do, and then, well, I guess I'm like everybody else. Sometimes I don't. But John would have had no patience with a Christ-honoring, denying, in the theological sense of the word, liberalism of our day. John in no fashion would have been, in a spiritual sense, a progressive. John believed in the old truths to be absolutely correct. John altered nothing from the prophets of old. And by the way, when the Son of God came on the scene, he didn't alter anything John preached. John changed nothing from the Old Testament. He did exactly what God sent him to do, and that was to preach a gospel of repentance, because the kingdom is at hand, and the kingdom is wherever, I've told you so many times, the king is. Now, the kingdom of heaven is in heaven right now. When the king comes back to earth, and the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God is going to be right here on this earth. John the Baptist is to be honored among all faithful, characteristic, godly people in the Old Testament and the New Testament, for Jesus said there was not a greater than John the Baptist. And yet most people say, John the Baptist, who wants to hear about John the Baptist? Well, God wanted us to hear about John the Baptist because he put quite a bit of him in the scripture. Amen. So I'm giving you as much as I can in the first 8 verses this morning. He believed exactly what Jesus Christ preached and taught. And by the way, Jesus Christ preached and taught exactly what John the Baptist preached and taught. Nothing changed. And how dare we in our day change the Bible in one jot or in one tittle? In other words, in the language of that day, little breathing mark, just a tiny little breathing mark that helps you how to pronounce a letter or pronounce a word in the Bible. Nothing will be changed. Jesus said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall never pass away. John the Baptist was loyal to the preserved word of God in his day, which was the Old Testament, New Testament not being written just yet. And he was extremely loyal to the incarnate word himself, the Son of God. Now, to John's preaching. First of all, John preached repentance. Words have power because words have meaning. You see that especially in the advertisements that I brought up as an example in our Sunday school class this morning, of the political parties and political leaders on television, hear them on radio and see them in the newsprint. Words have power. Everything I told the Sunday school class, I've told you on many occasions, and I'm telling you once again, context is everything. If you come to the Bible and you do not understand the Bible in its context, you do not understand the Bible. You say, well, the Bible says, I'm interested in everything the Bible says in its context. I'm really not interested in what the Bible says, according to some people, if it's taken out of its context, because then it becomes your theory, your idea, your opinion, and just like mine, they don't count. But if they're wedded to the very words of the living God's Bible, then they count as exactly what God wanted printed, preserved, and uttered today. That's why I will always, by the grace of God and doing my best, take you to the context of the Word of God. Now, we're going to look at John's preaching, and if I have enough time, we're going to look at John's baptizing. First of all, I said words have power. There are a couple of prepositions in this passage this morning, especially when you come to verse 4. I'm going to give you some meanings for prepositions. Now, if you are an English student and you enjoy studying English, most people were not English students and did not enjoy it. I did not enjoy it in high school. I did not understand it. I went to 4 high schools before I graduated. I kept trying to find one that would graduate me. That wasn't exactly how it worked out. My stepfather was in the military, and in those days, guys in the Army were moved around quite often. So the most I ever spent in one high school was in high school in Titusville, Florida. Some of you know where that is. I'm speaking to those who are watching online. So Titusville is in the north end of our county. I finally finished out 1.5 years. No, it was actually less than that. And graduated eventually from Titusville High School. Now, every high school I went to, because my dad, as I called him, my stepfather, my dad, would get transferred, then they would have subjects. I wanted to take language, for example. I start out in Spanish. 8 weeks later, we got to move. We moved to a school, and they teach French. Well, I couldn't take French there, but they didn't teach Spanish, so I had to wait until the next school year before I could start in French. Get in about 6 weeks of French. He gets orders. We're on the move again. Always wanted to take Latin. Never got to a high school that taught Latin, so I had to learn a little bit of Latin on my own. I'm not proficient in it, but at least I know enough about it to be dangerous. And then when I went to college, they put me as a freshman in the ministerial class, along with about 300 new freshman ministerial students, into an ancient Greek language, 5 days a week, 5 classes a week. Most college courses, some of them can be 1 class or 1 hour credit, 2 hours, a lot of them are 3 hours. This is a 5 hour credit. And they immersed us. I mean, they baptized us into that almost immediately. And I came out of those Greek classes over a couple of years' experiences, understanding now English. There are differences. There's a difference in ancient Greek, there's a difference in modern Greek. The letters are principally the same, but sometimes the understanding is different. Therefore, when you go to the Bible, which is written in what is called ancient Greek, or the Greek for the common man, as it was known in those days, there are differences in how words are used. For example, one preposition, the preposition is for, is used near the end of verse 4. It has in the English dictionary, and I've got a big thick dictionary, in fact I have two of them, they're about that thick, so they contain just about every word except for the very modern words that have come on the scenes in the last 15 or so years. There are 34 distinctive meanings for one preposition spelled F-O-R. Now to us it may only have 2 or 3 meanings, but the dictionary says it has 34 meanings. So I'm assuming that the My Webster dictionary is correct. So when I delve in, especially the last phrase in verse 4, and I give you some other meanings, you'll say, I don't see that in the Bible. It says for the remission of sins. Now everybody knows what for means. No, everybody doesn't know what for means. And there is so much confusion on baptism. I'll bring that up after I finish with page 1. Here we go with page 1, repentance. Verse 4. John did baptize in the wilderness. We'll work on that later. And preach the baptism of repentance. Of is a small, kind of like a preposition, but it's an auxiliary to a verb to help you understand the verb. John did preach the baptism of repentance. Stay with me. Now, when you hear what I'm going to tell you, you're going to say, he's changing the Bible. No, I'm helping us understand the Bible. The Bible was written a long time ago, translated in the preserved Word of God in 1611. 3 revisions since then. And so we have now the 1769, the 3rd revision for the Bible in the King James English, and it has remained such ever since. And I am convinced that all the other versions are not the preserved Word of God. I cannot spend time with 2, 3, 8, 10, 12, 15, 30, 40 different versions laid out on a table and walk back and forth and say, now which one is the Word of God? Because there are discrepancies and variances in all of them except this book. So I am committed here, and that's why I'm committed. You say, well, I like the New English Version. I like the English Standard Version. Well, like it if you want to. I am going to give you what I believe is the truth from the preserved, and if it's not preserved, then it ain't inspired. If it is inspired, it must be preserved, or inspiration is ridiculous. So we have the inspired Word of God before us this morning. Let's go to the baptism of repentance. Of. With reference to repentance, because of repentance, in token of repentance. You mean those phrases come out of that little word, O-F? Yes. Yes, in the biblical context, even in English, there is no, there never has been, never will be, a baptism that produces repentance. It doesn't happen. Now, almost all of Christianity, let me give you a big vague word, shall I, called Christendom. Now, all that means is wherever in the world Christianity is perhaps the dominant faith, that's called Christendom. Almost all of Christendom believes that somewhere in one person's life, that individual is ushered into the family or the kingdom of God on the basis of, because of, on account of baptism. Therefore, baptism is important. Very important. Extremely important. Because if you haven't been baptized, you don't stand the chance of an ice cube you know where. In other words, there's just no value. You just got to be baptized. In fact, we even have a rather prominent denomination in America and in some places in the world. I'm not giving the name of it right now, but you'll see their signs once in a while. And they maintain that if you're not baptized by one of their ordained ministers in their baptistry, you have not even been baptized. You've never been baptized. And they believe that without baptism, you have never been born again, will not be born again, and when you die and go into eternity, you don't go to the pearly gates. Now that's their doctrine. By the way, just a little hint, they in 1825 and 26 were a breakaway from a Baptist church in Kentucky that expelled a father and a son because of heretical teachings that I just described to you. So they were put out of the Baptist church and they went and started their own church. Now, this is what John preached clearly and distinctly. A repentance is a change in a mental attitude, and because mental is so easy, everything's easier said than done. Everybody agree with that? Say amen. Yeah, and those of you don't even understand what I'm talking about. Everything is easier said than done. You say it, it's easy, just say it. And it has no power, does nothing. So repentance from a biblical standpoint is a change in a mental attitude and will result in a moral conduct. There's always a result of repentance. Well, I repent of my sins. And then here I come, right back to them again. I'm over there, back to them again. There's been no repentance. If you have repented, you don't go back to that from which you have repented. This, by the way, I believe is a lost doctrine in most Baptist churches today. You don't hear it in most Baptist churches. But it's what John the Baptist preached, and Jesus Christ preached it, and the apostles throughout the New Testament preached it. And that's why we still preach it, because there it is in the book. He preached repentance. He preached the remission of sins. John did baptize in the wilderness and preached the baptism of repentance. People were baptized because of, that's that little word, O-F. They were baptized because of repentance. They did not repent, and then baptism just comes about as an automatic thing, and repentance means absolutely nothing. It's a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Now, I've already told you about 10 minutes ago, that little preposition for, in my dictionary, is used 34 distinct different times. You say, am I free to pick the one I want? Well, I hope so. Let me give you an example. I'd like to take a survey, but I could get in hot water taking a survey. So I'm going to take a virtual survey. I understand virtual to mean not real. Oh, but it's very real. Okay, have it your way. I don't understand all about all this modern jargon anyway. But virtual means similar to, like, as, almost, perhaps real, but not in person real. You know what I'm saying? If you have a virtual debate on TV, then you don't have a real person here and a real person there. But the people are real, I know, but they're not there, so it's called virtual. If you go to school, you're in a virtual classroom. You're not in a classroom. Oh yeah, you are in a classroom at home. I'm not interested in the details. Just stay with me. Don't get lost in the example, will you please? Here we go. I'd like to take a virtual a virtual question to you and survey. How many of you have been stopped for speeding? I've been stopped twice. Now, I could tell you about them. One of them happened on Interstate 75 south of Detroit, Michigan. at 3 a.m. in the morning. And I'm telling you, there was no traffic going north, and I was headed north with my family, and they were asleep in the car. And I'm telling you, there was no traffic in front of me or behind me. I was doing 70 miles an hour. I had speed control on 70 miles an hour. And I'm telling you the truth. Honestly, out of nowhere, there's a highway patrolman. I did not pass highway patrolman. I was very much alert at 3 in the morning. And I declared this guy, he must have come out of a helicopter that dropped him down behind me, but all of a sudden he's behind me, and I'm watching in my rearview mirror, and there's nothing behind me, and all of a sudden there he is, and the bubble gum was on the top of the vehicle at those times. We used to call those lights put on top of the vehicle, the blue lights, we call them bubble gum machines. And the bubble gum machine began to flash. He stops me and he says, "How fast are you going?" I said, 70. "What's the speed limit?" I said, 70. He said, "Wrong. The speed limit after dark drops to 65 miles per hour. You're going 5 miles an hour over the speed limit." I said, "Well, an officer, I was speeding." He said, "I know that." And he writes me up the ticket and told me where to go the next day to pay the $35 ticket. I'm telling you, I was innocent as a newborn babe. No, I wasn't. I was speeding. And the second time was about 30 years ago. I've told you that before, down in Palm Bay. But anyway, there I was going 5 miles over the speed limit again. Well, if you think, "Oh, they always give you 5 or 10 miles one way or the other," go ahead and bet your wallet on it if you want to. I can tell you it didn't work for me. All right, have you been stopped for speeding? Okay, here's my example. We're looking at the end of verse 4. John preached a baptism because of repentance on account of, since, in reference to, or in token of the remission of sins. He said, "What does that have to do with speeding?" Okay, for does not always mean purpose. It can. I could give you numbers of examples of how that little word for can mean purpose, for the purpose of. It doesn't mean that here. Well, how do you know it doesn't mean that here? Well, number one, from the language that Mark used in his day, and number two, from common biblical contextual sense. Oh. For example, were you speeding for the purpose of speeding? It doesn't make sense, you say. I know. Were you stopped for the purpose of speeding? F-O-R. For, got it? You understand now? Were you stopped for the purpose of speeding? Or were you stopped on account of speeding? Were you stopped, here we go, were you stopped to purpose speeding, help speeding, produce speeding? You say, "Well, no. That'd be silly." I know. And claiming that you have to be baptized in order to have your sins forgiven is just as silly. No one has ever been baptized in order to be forgiven of sins. But we take the little baby and we have the baby christened, and we hold the baby, or at least the priest does, in his arms. Or else the mother and the dad hold the baby, and the priest makes the sign of the cross with water from holy water. I'll tell you something, it's not Melbourne water if it's holy water. But nevertheless, he dips his finger in the water, and he puts the sign of the cross on the baby's forehead, and he baptizes or christens the baby. And in their theology, this takes away the taint of original sin. According to Scripture, it does nothing of the sort. But if you want to take something out of its context, You want to make it fit your preconceived opinion or your church's doctrine. You will find something eventually in the Bible that will give you a little bit of foundation for something like that. And then you build on that foundation, and you build and build and build. Well, the church says, the church teaches. I'm not interested in what the church says and what church teaches, but I am interested in what God's book says. And sometimes there can be a world of difference. And a world of difference can result in an eternity of difference. There are two places in eternity. They are not the same. They are different. And the difference that you and I may want to make down here by formulating doctrine like we want doctrine to be formulated, by fabricating truth and then projecting it like we want it to fit our preconceived opinions, can have disastrous results in eternity. And then there's no turning back. There is then no repentance. So this is what John preached. John did preach in the wilderness the baptism because of repentance for the remission of sins. Remission means a sending away, a removal of sins. Have your sins been remitted? I hope so. Mine were remitted on April the 29th, 1956, as a teenager, when I understood that my denominational baptism was of no value. When I was an 8-9 year old kid, I wanted to be baptized. Now I'd gone to the Baptist Sunday school. I was always in Sunday school every Sunday morning, depending on the family that, since we didn't have an automobile, stopped by our house and picked me up. I'm sitting on the front porch and I'm waiting for somebody to pick me up and take me to Sunday school. And there was always somebody that came by. I sometimes went to the Presbyterian church. I often went to the Baptist church. I ended up eventually in the Methodist church. And I wanted to be baptized. Why'd you want to be baptized? Well, because all my friends were baptized. Peer pressure. I want to be like my peers. If they're baptized, it must be important. I want to be baptized. So I volunteered for baptism. When the preacher at the Methodist church approached me, and he said, if you want to be a good Christian boy, you need to be baptized and join a church. Now listen to me. No reference against Methodist per se. I'm just telling you, this is the way it happened. This is the way it happened. I was there. I remember it. And the pastor of the church, where I usually ended up, he said, would you like to be a good Christian boy? And I said, yes, sir. He said, then, quote, you need to be baptized and join the church. Go home and ask your parents if you can be baptized and join the church. Now, he's saying, if you want to become a Christian boy, then you have to be baptized. My parents said, it's okay, we don't care as long as we don't have to go. And I think my mother did show up for the baptism. And so they, in their fashion, baptized me. I liked it. Why? Well, I'm just like all the other kids in my little elementary school. They're all Christians. Now I know that I'm a Christian. And by the way, the pastor told me I'd be a Christian if I got baptized. And so I went for years trusting what a church taught me, not ever knowing what the Bible really taught. So in my testimony I've given dozens and dozens of times, when I first heard the gospel as a young teenager, I didn't agree with this. I didn't like this. I didn't want to hear any more about that. Why? Because it taught about repentance. And I didn't want to repent. I liked the way I was living. I liked my rock music. I liked other sins that were part of my life. I didn't consider them big. I didn't really consider them important. But God did, because you see, God doesn't deal in black, white, or technicolored sins. We do. God doesn't deal in tiers of sins. We do. And my tier was probably on a scale of 1 to 5, 1, maybe a 2. Now 5, hey, now you're getting up where my father lived. That was a 5-tier, 5-star sins. So when I heard the gospel, I didn't pay attention to it. Wasn't interested. John preached repentance. John, by the way, when we go to verses 7 and 8, preached the Redeemer. I don't have a lot of time for this, so I'm not going to take a lot of time. All right, verse 7. Here's what he preached also. There cometh one mightier than I after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to stoop down and unloose. John understood in verse 7 his place. What's his place? Well, his place is back in verse 2 and 3. John understood his place. John understood why God had a purpose for his life. He was to prepare people through his preaching, and the baptizing was an identification of the preaching that John had given people. They took it to heart. And they were baptized, and they confessed their sins, as you see in the scripture. So that's John's ministry. He understood it, performed it. He was once asked, "Are you the Messiah?" He said, "No, I'm not the Messiah. I'm just preparing the way of the Messiah, or the anointed one of God, the chosen one of God who's to come." He understood exactly who Jesus was, even though it's very possible that Jesus was his cousin. He said that Jesus was before me. Now, I explained that a couple of weeks ago. Actually, John the Baptist was 6 months older than Jesus, but he said he was before me. How could he be before him? You came first, he's born 6 months later, and he's before you. Eternality of the Son of God. He knew who Jesus Christ was, even if it was his cousin. He knew exactly who he was, and he preached and presented him as such. He was saying, in effect, Jesus is a man, but he's more than a man. He is the Almighty Son of God, and he identified him as the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. What's the sin of the world? Okay, the sin of the world really is rebellion against God. That occurred in Eve's life. That occurred in Adam's life. They simply rebelled against God. And if I could put it in one word, that would be it. It's rebellion against God. I rebelled against God. I rebelled against gospel, I told you. And you may have done likewise. So I wasn't saved the first time I heard the gospel, and perhaps neither were you. But when we were saved, we were forgiven of the sin of rebellion against God. Now we want to live our lives and do things God's way. Now, verse 8. I have indeed baptized you with water. With reference to water. Oh, by the way, there's a word that you need to look at. W-I-T-H, verse 8. The first one is with. It means in reference to something. It has a number of meanings in the dictionary, so you got to be careful how a word is used. How should I know how some words are used? Compare scripture with scripture. That's how you'll find out. Paul talked about balancing spiritual things with spiritual words. Don't just see something in the Bible, pick it out, and say, "Hey, look, this, I found this in the Bible." Good. Did you find it in its context? And usually the response is like, duh. Context? What's context? Context is what God intended the Bible to say. To whom he gave it, why he gave it, why it was spoken on that occasion, what were all the circumstances, what the particular words meant that were used at that time. That's context. So if you want to pick something out of the Bible and say, "Do you realize the Bible says?" Yeah, I know. The Bible says Judas went out and hanged himself. Now, I could also get another passage or another part of a passage and say, "Go thou and do likewise." So Judas went out and hanged himself. Go thou and do likewise. You know, the Bible tells you ought to go out and hang yourself. Come on, you can't be serious. But some people are. They pick up things out of the Bible, slam them together, and here we go. And now you got a new cult on your hands. John's place is in verse 7. The Redeemer's priority is in verse 8. Now, Jesus baptized, he baptized through his disciples. He never did himself. And someday he's going to baptize, John said, in the power of the God's Holy Spirit. Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, same individual in the Bible. So I indeed baptized you with reference to water, but he, that is the coming Messiah, the Lord Jesus, shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. And by the way, that happened in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. Now, I said I wanted to go to baptism. Let me see what I can do in 5 or 6 or 7 minutes. Here we go. John did baptizing. verse 4. John did baptize in the wilderness. Verse 5. And there went out unto him all the land of Judea and they of Jerusalem, and were all baptized of him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Four things of importance about baptism. I'll run through this as quickly as I can. I know preachers always promise that and seem never to fulfill it, do they? Preacher always says, now let me give you four quick. Quick is a relative word. I'd like to say something real quickly. That's a relative word. Depends on what you mean by quick. So here we go. I want to give you four things quick. Let's see how we do. John is an authority for baptizing. There's always an authority for baptizing. In the Great Commission that Jesus gave, I don't have time to quote it. It's mentioned five times, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the first part of the book of Acts, chapter 1. Baptism is given to the church that Jesus founded by himself during his ministry to perform baptism and the Lord's Supper. Those are the two ordinances. What's an ordinance? That which is commanded. That means an ordinance. An ordinance means that. That's an ordinance. A Bible-believing church has two ordinances. You say, well, some wash feet. That's fine. You can comb hair too if you want to. There are only two ordinances, baptism and the Lord's Supper. And that's given to the church. It's not given to an individual. Well, John was an individual. I know, but John was a man sent from God, called of God, ordained of God. And that should settle it for John. John in his baptism was ordained from heaven. So it's mentioned in the Bible. Number two, Bible baptism requires a proper administration. Administration, that means how something is done. How is baptism done? The word baptize in the Bible means to dip, plunge, or immerse. Now, if you have a dishwasher at home, you're washing dishes, I suppose. What you're really doing is sprinkling them. So you put all your dirty dishes in the dishwasher, and you turn that thing on, and I'm assuming you don't have a glass view in the front of your dishwasher. I've not seen one. Maybe they make them. I don't know. But I know they do with washers, a regular clothes washer. Now, you can baptize your clothes. You can put them in a, not front loader, but you can put them in a top loader. Thing fills up with water, and all the clothes eventually go down under the water and come back up in the rotator and go down under and come back up. Now, the front loaders, you can't really do that, I don't think. But they got a glass. I don't think your dishwasher in your kitchen has a glass so that you can look through there and see all the dishes being not baptized, sprinkled. You say, I don't get it. Baptism is to dip, plunge, or immerse in a liquid. Now, if you want to try the sink, that's different. I'm assuming you're going to fill the sink up quarter, halfway with water, you're going to put soap in there, get it all messed up, and then you're going to put the dishes under the water. No, I pick them up out of the other side of the sink, hold them up in the air, and I scrub them, and then I rinse them. Do it any way you want to, but you got the idea, don't you? Therefore, Jesus had only one baptism that was administered by John the Baptist, and it was in the river Jordan. And the Bible says when he came up out of the water, it said so elsewhere in the New Testament of other people that were baptized. You got to have a sufficient amount of water. Why do you need so much water? It's such more convenient to just sprinkle or just pour a little bit of water. Have you ever seen, I enjoy art, I enjoy classic art. I've looked at a lot of classic art where I went to college, where Brother Togerson went to college. Classic art, Museum of Fine Arts was there. And you went through that many times, I'm sure, as all of us did. And there will be paintings by the great masters of centuries gone by, and they're very expensive paintings, and they show Jesus being baptized. He's standing in the River Jordan in knee-deep water, and John the Baptist is standing beside him with a pitcher, and he's pouring water over his head. Well, he can pour water over Jesus' head in Jerusalem. He could do that out in the desert with just a little spring in the desert. But he goes to the River Jordan. Why? You need much water. Why do you need so much water? Because baptism is a picture of the death, the burial, burial is kind of under, you know what I'm saying? Death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's not just a washing as pictured. It's a burial that's being pictured. Number three, I said I'd have to do this quickly. Who is the applicant for a baptism? Somebody that's been saved. When my pastor told me the day that I trusted Christ as my Savior that I would be baptized that night, I immediately responded respectfully. I said, Pastor, I've been baptized. Remember what I told you about 10 minutes ago? I said, I've been baptized. He said, no, that doesn't count. Huh? I'm thinking, I asked him, I said, what do you mean? Why doesn't it count? And he began to explain things to me. And then I began to understand. He said, look, when were you saved? I said, about 5 minutes ago, I asked Jesus Christ to forgive me and save me. I trusted him as my Savior. I even walked forward in church because I wanted to declare my confession of faith in Christ. And he said, well, you've been saved for 5 minutes? I said, yes, sir. He said, did you get baptized after you were saved? Well, of course not. He said, you need to be baptized. He said, baptism is for believers only. Believers only. Baptists practice that. Most churches do not. Now, some do. Most do not. If you want to be a member of a church, come on in. Come on in, my friend. We're glad to have you. We want more members. More members means more money in the offering plate. You say, you make that sound so crude. Well, that's exactly about what it amounts to. More members you have, the more money you're going to have coming in the offering plate. Common sense, isn't it? Not spiritual sense, but common sense. And so he said, you need to be baptized because it is a public identification of your now new birth and relationship to Jesus Christ, your personal Savior. I said, yes, sir, what do I need to be baptized? What do I need to bring tonight? And he told me and I was baptized. What about the first baptism? Just erase it. Like a mark on a whiteboard, just take the eraser and erase it. Didn't mean anything. I wasn't saved then. I wasn't a believer. You see, we preach what the Bible preaches, blood before water. The blood of Christ cleansing you and me of our sins before any baptism of any fashion. Blood before water. Not after, not to produce the cleansing. No. What can wash away my sins? Nothing. Nothing but what? The blood of Jesus. That's right. John confronted the hypocrisy of his day and challenged the traditions as the way into the kingdom of God. And yet churches are still saying, the way to the kingdom of God is the baptism. Come into the church, everybody. Please come into the church. The church is the doorway to the kingdom of God. No, no. Christ is the door. He said that. Some people brag about, well, he gave to Peter keys to the kingdom. I like what old B.R. Lakin, great man of God of years and years gone by. He's been with the Lord for years now. I knew B.R. Lakin personally. He lived in Titusville. I personally sat several times on his front porch, and we talked about things spiritual from the Bible. Great man of God. I always like to hear B.R. Lakin say in his old West Virginia accent, he said, you say Peter's got the keys to the kingdom? Let old Peter keep the keys. I've got the door. All right. Number four. Hadn't been too quick yet, has it? Application. Why be baptized? What is the purpose? The purpose of baptism is to say, I have confessed my sins, and beginning with the sin of unbelief, which is rebellion. I have confessed my sins unto God. That's called repentance. That's involved in repentance, by the way. If you're not confessing your sins, you're not repenting. If you're not confessing to God, you're not repenting. You say, well, I've done a few things wrong. I could have done some things right, could have done them better. And I mean, that means nothing. There's no sorrow in it. There's no regret that you've offended a holy God. None of that's taken into account. You just want to feel better. All right, confessing your sins. Baptism is a sign, a symbol, an emblem of conviction by the Holy Spirit of God that I'm a sinner and I'm worthy of hell, never heaven. It's a sign that I have been converted because I've confessed my sins. And I really have not converted, but Jesus Christ has converted me 180 degrees. That's conversion. It's a sign that I am now confessing Christ openly, publicly, before all who will witness it. That I am a sinner now, but I'm a sinner saved by grace. And I'm making a commitment to follow Jesus Christ. Now, if you've been baptized, when, where, how, why? And if you believe that it has anything to do with your personal salvation relationship to the Savior, may I just put it bluntly? Forget it. It doesn't. Stand with me for prayer. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. For those who are watching elsewhere and those who are in the audience with me this morning, baptism is important, but in the brief sense that I've had to give you, I've tried to give you the sense and the truth of what baptism is and what it is not. So if I ask you if you've been baptized, as I concluded 2 minutes ago, why were you baptized? Thing to do? Parents wanted it? Everybody expected it? You wanted to fit in? You believed that somehow it would help you someday when you have to stand before God to be able to say to Him, well, I got baptized. Why have you been baptized? For the reason that God gives in the book, or for your own personal support? Father, someone in this audience may need to be saved. Not baptized. Not baptized again. Just need to be saved. Someone watching may need to be saved. Thou knowest, I only see eyes, as I often say, thou dost see the heart. May someone in this audience that needs to be saved come to Christ this morning. May he or she step forward as soon as this prayer is over and we still have an attitude of prayer, and come and say, Pastor, I want to make sure I'm saved. I want to make sure. And make sure before he or she leaves this property today that baptism has nothing to do with being saved except to be a symbol of it, an outward expression of an inward experience. Help people to understand that. In the Savior's name I pray. Heads are still bowed. Miss Joanne's going to play for us. I'm going to be on the main floor here. I'm not take much of your time now. We're just about finished. But new life can just be beginning for you. This could be the day that you confess openly Jesus Christ as your Savior. And then, yes, then, you should follow Him in obedience to His command of baptism. But don't do it because you say, I want to make sure I'm going to heaven, so I'm going to get baptized. It's not going to have a thing to do with it. You say, I'm coming this morning, Pastor. I'm coming to confess Christ as my Savior. I'm convicted and convinced by the Holy Spirit of God that I need to be born again. And baptism isn't it. Therefore, I'm coming this morning to confess openly that I've trusted in Christ as my Savior. You say, I've never done that. You need to. Do it now. No pressure is applied, just an invitation. My Father, which art in heaven, I have done the best I can do of explaining things from thy book. Lord, I've kept within the context, and I've kept within the statements elsewhere in Scripture regarding preaching and baptizing. I've lifted up the Word of God the best I know how, and I hope I've honored the Savior in everything that I've said and done. May the Word of God yet find lodging in people's hearts. Help us to go out and carry the gospel. Bless our rest today, now coming together tonight. In the Savior's name I pray, amen.